Do you ever go out to sushi and just like, is that one of the things you just love? And yet you're just trying to conceive, so maybe you're questioning, is that something I should be having? Should I be eating sushi? Can I enjoy my sushi with my friends or with my partner? Well, I'm gonna say no, but let's talk about that. Go ahead and grab your tea or your water. I'm having water today. Just finished a great workout. So grab your tea and or your water and come join me and let's talk about the things that are that you can have and some things that maybe you don't want to have right now. I'm Denise Noyer-Erez and I am known as the Fertility Godmother, and today we're going to talk about four things that you can do to improve your fertility just by the way you choose to eat. So we're going to touch base on those three things right now, and if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them in the chat and I'd be happy to answer them. Thank you for sending me them ahead of time so that I have them right here. I'll go over them later. I'll go over those questions at the end of our talk. Hi, thanks for joining. I don't know how to say your name, but thanks for joining. Hi, Tatiana. Hi, Haley. Great to see you guys. Sorry, I don't know how to say that. 81 joined. Thanks for joining. It's great. All right. So, you're having some chicken bone broth right now. That's fantastic. That's fantastic. Chicken bone broth is really, really healthy and important for you. So let's talk about sushi, because I know I get this all the time about, can you have sushi? Or what does it mean to have sushi? So first of all, if you're trying to get pregnant, and fish is really healthy, it's really important. The trick is you wanna really make sure that you're having low mercury fish, right? So you probably are familiar with that, just from a health standpoint of being cautious of the mercury levels that are in our fish. So tuna, which is a lot of times in sushi, right? In tuna, like there's albacore, those are all different, yellowtail, those are all different forms of tuna. So we have to be careful of how much you're having. So usually what I throw back at you is, will you be eating sushi when you're pregnant? So I believe that you want to treat your body as if you're pregnant, because I know that when you get pregnant, you're going to be taking such good care of yourself. And it's really important to really lay those habits down right now as you're trying to get pregnant beforehand, because not only will it help you when you are pregnant, but it's going to help you sustain your after you're pregnant, because you're going to need to keep your energy up. You're going to need to be able to run around. And so all these habits that you have right now are going to be able to sustain you longer. So sushi, probably not, but there are cooked forms of sushi, right? So you can go and enjoy some of that sushi. The other thing, I want to do a little poll right now. What snack food do you think decreases your chances of getting pregnant every time you eat it? Can you share with me? It's a little bit, you might be surprised. You probably go and grab it every time you wanna go watch Netflix on the couch with your honey. Okay, so what it is, carbs. That's a good guess, no, but no, not carbs. Chocolate, that's another good guess, no, chocolate. Chocolate is, dark chocolate is actually okay if you like it. We've got a couple chips, popcorn. Yes, exactly. It's the chips. So really what that category is, it's the trans fats. The trans fats are so debilitating and inhibiting you from getting pregnant every time you eat it. And really, it's just a bag of chips. 2% of your total daily caloric intake can really decrease your chances of ovulating 73%. That's huge. So what I like to do, because there's always studies, you guys, you're probably, if you're Googling, and I hope you find somebody like myself as a good resource. There's so many different studies out there, but we know that trans fats affect your overall health, and we know that it affects your chances of ovulating. So if you really want to increase your chances of getting pregnant, you want to minimize those trans fats. So you can get healthy snacks instead. Maybe make some kale chips yourself, or if you really want to nosh, or just know so you're making a choice. You can counterbalance it by having some extra greens, maybe a green drink or some green pills, something, a wheatgrass shot to help kind of balance that out for those splurges. But definitely not an everyday type of event. I know at one point myself, my husband and I, it would be our little downtime. We'd like to watch a comedy, munch on some popcorn, drink a glass of wine. Really not a good habit to be in. So probably not. Yes, veggies with hummus is much better. It's healthier. You're getting the nutrients in there. It's still crunchy. I don't know about you, but for me, it's that crunchy, right? You like the crunchy. I think that's so important to be able to enjoy. So that veggies and hummus is good. You can also do like a, if you really want popcorn, maybe get some organic popcorn with some grapeseed oil and just make it on the stove. I'm doing this because not the Jiffy Pop. I don't know if you guys are probably too young for the Jiffy Pop. I don't know if it's still out or not. That's a trans, definitely has a lot of trans fats in it on that Jiffy Pop. Yes, carrots are great. Cucumbers, peppers, all those things instead of that bag of chips. And you can, if you really are craving salt, salt's not necessarily a bad thing. So you can add a little salt and make it a little salty, crunchy snack for yourself. And you know, kale chips, if you want to make some, they don't, if you really just want that texture, there's beet chips. I know Haley introduced me to beet chips. She loves those. So the trans fats are listed as trans fats, not always. So what you want to do is, I was just going to get into that. Thanks for asking that. What you want to do is you want to look at the label. You want to get real familiar with what you're putting in your body, because I know you're going to be doing that when you're pregnant. So let's start now and do it. And you want to read the label, and anything that says partially hydrogenated or hydrogenated fats, that's when they break down the fat, and that's when it causes a lot of free radicals and a lot of havoc in your body, and it damages your cells. So we know for sure, we know for years now, not for sure, but we've known for, I don't know, 30, 40 years, that trans fats really affect your heart health, which is gonna affect every cell in your body. And now, in the last 10 years, we know that it affects your fertility. So that's huge, makes a big, big difference. Pickles are great. Okay, anything that is marinated is so great for your microbiome. Those cabbage or pickles, it's another cabbage, what's it called? It's kind of a German food. I always think of it as German food. It's real good. I can't think of it right now, but so good for prebiotics and helping create a nice microbiome, which means you have a good digestive system, and it's so, so helpful for you. Sauerkraut, yes, thank you, sauerkraut. I couldn't think of sauerkraut. So those are some things that are gonna be really good for you. So now, now that we know that trans fats decrease your chances of conceiving 73%, okay, that's not gonna help you get healthy. I don't know what will. And only such a little bit, so crazy. Did you know that green tea can increase your chances just by having a half a cup a day by 50%? Isn't that crazy? So you want to counterbalance that. So now, honestly, I don't know if it's 50%. I was reading, I didn't find an actual study on this, but let's just unpack what green tea offers you, okay? And I know there's some concerns about it. So yes, it can be with caffeine, because green tea doesn't have a lot of caffeine in it. It has a little bit of caffeine in it. So a lot of people think green tea, matcha, they ask me, okay, if I can't drink coffee, can I drink matcha? So matcha is pretty high up there in the caffeine, but it has great antioxidants. So green tea, even with caffeine, if you're gonna have a maximum of one cup a day, it has a lot of phytonutrients in it and polyphenols, which really help protect your cells, right? The antioxidants that protect your cells. The other concern, the other concern is that green tea, and if you drink too much, can deplete some minerals like folic acid, and folic acid or folate, as you know, is so important when you're trying to conceive. But you're probably, and if you're not, you want to be supplementing right now with a prenatal vitamin and eating lots of green vegetables, because it's going to be so important for your overall health. So you should be getting plenty of folate, and having one cup of tea, green tea, or even two cups of green tea won't really deplete you, and you're going to be supplementing and eating those green vegetables anyway, especially since you won't be having that popcorn and those chips when you're watching that Netflix show. You can supplement it with some greens, so I know you're going to get plenty of that, and that will be really, really helpful for you. So those are some things that are really important, some key secrets to helping you on your journey of getting pregnant. So just a quick recap, we talked about sushi. So if you're gonna go for sushi, you want to try to just act as if you were pregnant, okay? That's always my tip. Will you choose the tuna, the raw tuna? Probably not the best idea, and if, especially if you go frequently. If you have a bite of your partner's, that's probably fine, but choose cooked forms of sushi. I know it's not as exciting, but you're gonna get the texture, you're gonna get, and it'll be much healthier for you. Does methylfolate count? Methylfolate is the best form of getting your folate if you're not gonna eat it, and we definitely need a supplement. So there's methylfolate, folate, and then folic acid. So those are in that order, is the best source of folate to get. So it's really important to make sure that you're getting a good amount of folate. So I'm gonna go ahead and answer a couple of questions. One of them was sushi, which is why I opened up with sushi. I love sushi too. So just be mindful of that, okay? Another question I got beforehand was, how long should I eat for a fertility diet? Well, I think that eating gives you so much power over your health, you know, which really translates into your fertility and when you get pregnant and after you have a baby. So it's so important for you to eat healthy long-term and really create it as a lifestyle. So it's not necessarily, you know, it's a process, right? I mean, I've become really healthy over the years just by doing my cleanses and being a nutritionist and being an athlete my whole life. I've been lucky, but I've trained my body, I've trained my mind to make certain choices. And because I had goals, right? And your goals are, you want to get pregnant, you want to have a healthy baby, and you want to have energy to play with your baby. So really sustaining a healthy lifestyle for long term is so important. I want to say for as long as you can. So just take little steps. So tell me, what's one thing you can do that would just, you know, take steps so it's not overwhelming? One thing, choose one thing that you could do right now that would help you improve your eating habits for your overall health and your fertility. Just give me, if you want to share, just think about it. And just be consistent. Consistency is going to be the key. Does that mean, you know, you could never have popcorn again, since we're talking about that as we're watching a movie? No, of course not. It just means you make different choices most of the time. Okay, what else? How does my husband need to eat healthy too? Absolutely. So important for both of you to be really healthy, because you're giving, right? Let's think about what makes a baby. You know, the egg and the sperm, but really what happens is, it's when they undress all of that, it's the DNA. So whatever you're putting in your body, it's going to affect the genetics or the epigenetics, or how healthy the structure of that DNA is when they meet, which is going to impact the health of your baby. So important, both of you, to be eating as healthy as possible. And, you know, 3 months beforehand is a minimum of how long you should be healthy. Maybe that's what the other person was asking me. How long should I eat a fertility diet? Or specifically, you want to be healthy at least 3 months before you try to conceive. So important. Exchange chips for something else. Yes. Oh, good. You're going to exchange chips for something else. Woohoo. Way to go. Excited about that. Good for you. Okay. How much does my diet matter? Your diet is huge, because think about it. Whatever you're putting in your body, those different choices, you're going to be eating. You eat throughout the day, every day, right? Everything we put in our bodies. So you've heard that saying, you are what you eat. So there's truth to that, in whatever we're eating is in our body, and whatever we eats is in our body, which is another reason why like organic foods and grass-fed and products like, you know, grass-fed beef or pasture-raised chicken and eggs are so important. Because, for example, chickens, they don't eat soy and corn. I love it, they have vegetarian fed, but chickens aren't vegetarians. So, you know, you want whatever they're eating, we're eating, it becomes a part of our body. So what you choose to eat is so important. And as you can see, just 2% of your calories coming from unhealthy foods like trans fats can significantly decrease your chances of ovulating. My partner drinks red wine at the weekend, but his sperm is good, so he says he doesn't need to stop. What do you think? That's a great question. And so, you know, for, it's great that he has good sperm, and I see a lot of times when the male partners have good sperm, they don't think that they need to do anything else. And I can't say that's farther from the truth. So it really depends how much wine he's drinking. So I like to say a limit of 4 glasses per week. So if he's drinking 2 glasses on the weekend of wine, of red wine, then that's not necessarily, that's not gonna hurt so much. But if you're doing more than that, you definitely want to cut back. And for women, since we're talking about alcohol, you know, you have to think about you have to factor in a lot of different things, like what are the reasons you're not conceiving. And then if you're actively trying, you have to stop drinking after you ovulate. So important. You cannot drink through the whole month if you're actively trying to conceive, because as soon as you hit fertilization, then you're going to impact the development of that baby right then and there. And it starts before you even know you're pregnant, which is so, so important. Okay. So I do think, I don't know how much he's drinking, but I do think that you shouldn't have more than 4 drinks a week of alcoholic beverages a week. Any foods to eat or not eat the night before the transfer? Oh, that's what, I had another one about the pineapple. So I'm gonna just link that right in. So it really, Katie, I think it really depends on your body and what you should eat or shouldn't eat. So I like to recommend red meat. Something that's in a lot of green vegetables. So you are, and not just the night before, but to build your body up, to build the blood up, to help create a good environment for your body. Warm foods tend to be better because you want a warm, comfortable environment. Warm foods, if you think about it, warm is more flowy and, you know, circulation, where we use cold to constrict blood flow, right? So I think if you have more of the warm, nourishing foods, that can be more beneficial for you. But it depends really on, you know, the way I look at it is I look at everybody so differently, depending on what's happening on in their body. Let's see. Hi, Ken. Look, Tatiana said, is turkey preferred over chicken? No, it's not preferred. It's what you prefer. If you do have turkey, maybe you want to have dark meat. Turkey has a little bit more fat in there, a little bit more blood. The way I like to talk is like, is it nourishing my body? Is it nourishing my blood? Is it nourishing my cells? That's how I think when I look at foods. So that would be it. Thank you so much. I think whatever you prefer, chicken and turkey are pretty equal. I do recommend that you have beef, red grass-fed beef, you know, at least 3 servings a week when you're trying to conceive. Because again, when you're pregnant, I like to say you're going to have this little parasite inside of you, and they need that environment. They're going to be taking everything out, and blood is a big deal. So to nourish your uterus, to nourish your ovaries, to nourish the baby and the placenta, and then you're going to need it after, because he's going to take a lot out of you when you get pregnant. Those are great questions. Can I drink? We haven't talked about the drinking, and those are the questions that I got beforehand. Oh, should I eat pineapple? I wanted to just touch base on that because I know I get that a lot. Should I eat pineapple during my, should I eat pineapple even after the retrieval or after ovulation, right? Because there's the stories about the bromelain from the pineapple. So So I think that you probably don't need to eat a ton of pineapple. If you enjoy pineapple, have a little bit. But pineapple is really acidic. It's really sugary, right? So you don't want to eat a lot of it. And I know there's some people that say eat the core. The core is really bitter. So no, I don't find any difference in having the bromelain. And sometimes I wonder if it could be counterproductive as well. There's some mixed studies on that, because really implantation is an inflammatory reaction. And so you don't want to necessarily decrease inflammation too much at that stage. That could get a little complicated, which I can help you with if you're curious. Raw meat, didn't know that. Yes, raw meat. Yeah, not raw meat, red meat. Don't eat raw meat. Red meat is really important to nourish your body and the marrow. So bone broth is really great. So some people who I know have a hard time eating red meat, I actually asked them to start with the bone broth. But bone broth is so good for you in so many ways. It has, again, you're getting the nourishment from the marrow, and you're getting the probiotics in there. It's really good for your digestion. So it's a great place to start any type of bone broth, whether it's chicken or beef or whatever you may be. Citrus is fine. Yeah, a little bit of citrus is great. Lemons and are really, really healthy. They help alkalinize your water. They make it taste good. I just got off the phone with I did a coaching call the other day, and the lady I was talking to did not like water. But she did like to put lemon in her water. So we talked about buying some lemons, cutting them up ahead of time, right? Which is the key, is planning your week ahead of time, right? And so she can just throw some lemons in her water, so it can help her get off some of those other drinks that are important. A good alternative tip with bone broth. Yes, absolutely. I'm guessing unrefined carbs aren't great. That's correct. Unrefined carbs are not great. But the carbs are fine. In fact, carbohydrates are important, I think, in women's health in particularly. So my rule of thumb is limiting it to 2 to 3 servings of carbohydrates a day. So whether you're going to have a slice of bread, if you're somebody that can eat bread, you want to get a whole grain bread, that's great. But that would count as one of your serving sizes. It's so important. White pastas once in a while, if you want to balance it out, or if you go out to dinner, you can have it. For me, once in a while is about 20%, 15% of the time. And I like to look at the whole week. Good question, Lisa. Yes, it was a really good question. Lots of tangerines. Okay, you're getting lots of vitamin C. That's great. Vitamin C is really good for your blood vessels, and your fertility has some great antioxidants. It's good for your immune system. Good idea. Oh, no frozen screen. I froze? Did I freeze? I can't tell if I froze. Looks like I'm moving. All right, you guys. If you want some more information, please go to my, in my bio. Okay, not frozen. Must have been her. Thanks, Haley. Please go to my bio and click the Fertility Godmother Diet, and you can look at a lot of great information. Haley helped me create this beautiful little booklet for you that you can download and get some really good information. And of course, I'm always here for you if you need some additional help. Thank you so much for being here. The free resources. Yes, it's in the free resources. I have a ton of gifts there for you. And there's some great ones about diet. And next week, I am going on an American road trip with my family. So I will have a pre-recorded video for you, and I will be sharing with you along the way some tips about eating while traveling. All right, so thank you so much, and I look forward to seeing you guys soon. Take care and make it a great week. And remember to do one thing that you can do to improve your health and your fertility. Thank you so much.